Good day, everyone. I am Rachna Makhija, Senior Research Analyst with iFAST Financial India Private Limited. I'm here with another informative fun interaction session. Today, we are going to discuss on the recently closed NFO, Mirae Nifty Financial Services ETF, which invests into the underlying index, Nifty Financial Services Index. It includes stocks pertaining to financial services, banks, insurance companies, AMCs, and other financial services. To discuss in detail, we have here with us Mr. Siddharth Srivastava, Head of Products and ETF from Mirae AMC. Siddharth has more than 10 years of experience in financial services and stock markets and currently leads the passive investment products with Mirae AMC. Welcome, Siddharth, to the session. Over to you.
Thank you, Rachna. Thank you for the kind introduction and happy to do this session.
Great. So, Siddharth, if you could just give a bit introduction about your product.
Yeah, so Rachna, this is India's first ETF, which will be based on Nifty Financial Services Index. So as you might be aware, there are a lot of ETFs which are based on Nifty Bank. Some of them are based on private bank. One is based on PSU Bank also. But this is the first ETF which will provide exposure to a broader set of companies forming part of financial services sector. So this is a 20 stock index. It has a very rich history of 16 years in terms of performance. It has done quite well compared to Nifty 50 as well as Nifty Bank in long-term horizon. So we feel that this is a very good offering for a sector which we believe will outperform the broad market in a long-term period.
Yes, definitely. Basically, this product gives an exposure to the entire gamut of India's financial story. So I have a few questions. If I can start with that.
Sure. Go ahead, Rachna.
Sure. So my first question is, you know, since this index, it invests 62% in the banking, including the private and the PSUs. What's your take on this sector at this point of time in terms of various factors like the credit growth, asset quality and net interest margins?
Sure. I think first I would like to make it clear that this is a passive product. It tracks an index and it doesn't look at valuation per se, and the investments are directly done in the underlying portfolio of the index. Having said that, index, because it gets rebalanced continuously, so whichever stocks are performing well continue to remain part of the index, probably at a higher weightage, and whichever stocks are not performing well, their FFM cap goes down. So either their weightage is reduced or they move out of the index. So it's a natural churn which happens. Like it happens in case of, let's say, a Nifty 50 or a Next 50. Same case happens with financial services index also. It's also important to note that at times beta exposure is very good because, for example, in last 3, 5, and 7 year period, no active BFSI active mutual fund has outperformed this benchmark. So we feel that this segment is a segment where passive play will work. And that's why we have come out with this product. Now, onto the sector as a whole, we feel that, obviously I've mentioned that from a long-term growth point of view, we are very bullish on this particular sector. And that's why we have an existing active fund and we are coming out with a passive fund in this. On the banking specifically, yes, a particular product not only consists of banks, but also consists of life insurance, general insurance, NBFCs, HFCs, AMCs, and other financial services. If you look at recent history, we see that banks in terms of asset quality has definitely improved. The gross NPA has gone down from 9-point-something% in 2019 to almost 7.5% in March 2021. Even when we are looking at provision coverage ratio for these banks, it has increased from 60% to almost 69% in March 2021. the 60% was there in March 2019. So a lot of steps which have been taken by RBI and these banks have improved the asset quality of the bank as of now, and also the corporate sector as a whole we feel is right now more robust. So it is expected that overall picture of bank from an asset quality point of view, from an NPA point of view, is much more robust than before. And as we move out of this pandemic, as the credit growth increases and corporate becomes more robust from an earning point of view, we feel that this will have a positive impact on banks also.
Yes, definitely. So, okay, in your view, do you think, you know, considering the India's low penetration in the insurance and also AMCs are rightly placed in terms of their AUMs, do you think these sectors offer alpha returns to the portfolio, one's portfolio?
So, there are two things which are working and which probably will work in favor of financial services sector. One, you have already mentioned low penetration. So if you're looking at as of 2019, the penetration of life insurance was around 2.8% compared to the global average of 3.3%. The non-life insurance is around 0.94% only compared to the global average of 3.8%. Even when we look at AMC business, which has grown so much, even at an excess of 30 lakh crores in AUM, it's only 12% of India's GDP, whereas global average is somewhere around 55%. So be it be insurance, be it be AMC, be it be other product and services, we feel that while financial inclusion has increased, it has a long way to go before it reached global averages. So that provides a huge opportunity for this sector, because a lot of segments are untapped, a lot of masses still don't have access to a lot of these things, and we feel that provides a great opportunity. Second thing which we feel will work in favor of this particular segment is the rise of digitalization and financial services sector. The main example being the digital wallets, right? If you look at 2020-21 only, more than 19 lakh crores worth of transaction was done by UPI, and almost 1 lakh crore through RuPay card. So a lot of interesting products and services are being innovated, are being offered now. And I think this will have a ripple effect, not only in these upcoming companies, but also on the entire sector, because that will improve the efficiency and the operational performance of, let's say, even banks. As financial services grows, a lot of these innovation also will get passed on to these legacy segments of the financial services also.
Yes, definitely. The integration of financial services into this industry has all the way marked changing landscape for this sector. Correct. So, my third question is related to, you know, most of the active funds usually have a good allocation to the sector, BFSI sector as a whole. So, why should one complement this fund in their portfolio?
So that's a good question, and that question is perhaps true for a lot of sectoral passive funds or ETFs which are there, right? So it depends first of all on the investor's risk profile and investor's objective, right? If he or she believes that from a long-term point of view, a BFSI or let's say a consumption sector is going to do well, then he can obviously add more weightage to the concerned sector by investing in the ETF. So also second thing can be if he feels that from an overall allocation point of view in his portfolio, let's say, while he may have invested in, let's say, a large cap or a mid cap or a flexi cap, probably in an international product, but he feels that from an overall allocation point of view, he still have lower allocation to financial services, then he can take an exposure in this ETF also. So it plays twofold. First, if he feels that opportunity is there in this particular sector, we know that a lot of cyclicals have run really well. Perhaps financial services have not run up that much compared to the other segment of the market. So it depends from a short-term point of view, from a long-term point of view. If investor believe that there is an alpha in this particular sector, then this is the product for him. And from an allocation point of view, if he is currently under-allocated in financial services, then also this particular ETF makes sense for the concerned investor.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, definitely. If one is positive on this sector, then through his portfolio, we can go overweight on this sector through this sector tactical allocation.
Correct.
Okay. So, since Mirai already has a banking and financial services fund, which was launched around December 2020. So, what underlying factors should an investor consider before choosing between your active thematic BFSI fund or a passive BFSI fund?
So, first of all, having both active and passive product in the same space just highlights our conviction in this particular sector. And I think from a selection point of view, it's not very different from, let's say, a choice between a large cap fund and Nifty 50, right? Whether you should invest in a large cap active mutual fund or an Nifty 50. Same concepts can be applied while choosing an active fund or a passive fund here also. If you want to take a beta exposure, right? If you want to just take your market exposure, then you can obviously invest in an ETF. If you want to reduce the overall cost of your portfolio, take an exposure at a low cost, then you can invest in this ETF because we will price this ETF around just 13 basis point. So that is one of the cheapest product from in the market in this space from a TR point of view. So it depends from investor to investor. We believe that active plus passive is a good way to take exposure broadly. So you can, if you believe in some particular fund management, then you can take an active course and blend it with some amount of passive, because that what it will do is you will have a section where you will continue getting a market return, whereas you can ride out the fund manager performance cycle and get returns from the active fund also.
Okay, and Siddharth, how would you minimize the tracking error?
So I think tracking error, we have been able to do it quite well, manage it quite well in our Nifty 50, ESG, even our FANG Plus product also. In fact, for a FANG Plus, the tracking error, despite of being an international product, is just around 10 basis point. For Nifty 50, this year it's around, I guess, 2 basis point. So we have been doing it quite well. I think for this product also, since all the underlying stocks are fairly liquid, we don't foresee any issue in having a very low tracking error for this product also.
Okay, sure. And how will be the liquidity managers, the market maker facility available in this ETF too?
Yes, so I think one of the key benefits of Mirai Asset ETFs is that we have our own in-house sister concern, Mirai Asset Capital Markets, who provides liquidity on the exchange by acting as an authorized participant in all our ETFs. What it does is that we are able to provide continuous liquidity on the exchange around the real-time net asset value and with almost no effective spread. So both the buy side and the sell side happens on cost-to-cost basis. And probably that is why a lot of investors have, in fact, instead of buying directly through the AMC, have preferred to buy it on the exchange also. And same service benefit will continue to provide not only in Nifty, Mirai Asset Nifty Financial Services ETF, but also in any other ETF which we are going to come in future also on the domestic side.
Yes, definitely. Mirai Asset is really doing very well for the passive products too.
And that's
so. Can you summarize, key takeaways about this product?
Sure. I think, as I mentioned earlier, this is India's first ETF on Nifty Financial Services Index. It is India's first ETF which will provide exposure to the entire financial services sector. From a performance point of view, historically, this index has done really well compared to Nifty 50 and Nifty Bank in long-term horizon. Even if you look at rolling return, it has generated decent alpha over Nifty 50 and Nifty Bank both. And also, if you're comparing whether this is an efficient segment of the market, you only need to look at last 3, 5, or 7 year returns, where you can see that this index has outperformed all the active BFSI funds by a significant margin, I think almost 4.8% on an average in the last 3 years. And lastly, I think this will be a very low cost offering from our side at just 13 basis point. It makes a lot of sense to take exposure in this sector, which we have a lot of conviction in. We believe that this is a long-term play to invest in BFSI space right now, considering, as I mentioned earlier, the low penetration of various products and services and kind of product innovations and new services which are coming out. So all in all, we feel that this product, which is first time out in the market, makes a lot of sense for the investor to take exposure in. And then from a unit price point of view, it will be fairly liquid on both NSE and BSE. And I think the per unit price will be around 16 to 17 rupees, depending on the index value on the allotment date.
Yes, definitely. So the investors who are bullish on this BFSI sector as a space, so should consider this fund for their tactical allocations. In fact, thank you for the insightful session. It was a really good informative session for all of us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rishna, for having me. Have a great day.
You too. Bye.